Hi guys, this is Sai Madhav. Welcome to part 2 of Professional Ethics. In the first video, we have discussed about schedule 1, that is first schedule. In this video, we will go with second schedule. Before going to that, we will learn how to remember the first schedule. You know there are 12 clauses, right? How to remember that? We can remember by a small story, okay? See this. NPAPSSDCACBSIN. Okay, you form into a story like you bought a national permit car in Andhra Pradesh. You bought an SSD card. SSD means memory card, right? SSD card. You wrote CACB and signed on it. Okay, you bought a national permit car in Andhra Pradesh. You bought a SSD card, wrote CACB and signed on it. Now, there are 12 letters here. N, P, A, P, SSD, CA, CB and signing. Now first N is for name. It is letting use of your firm name to others. Second clause is P, pays or agrees to pay. Third one is A, A stands for accepts or agrees to accept. Fourth one, P, P stands for partnership, that is forming partnership with other professionals. Fifth one, S for secures business, okay, secures work by means not achievable for CS. The sixth one, S stands for soliciting clients, okay. Seventh one, designation, D, using designation other than a chartered accountant. Eighth, C stands for communicating. Before you accept an audit, you should communicate to the previous auditor. Ninth one, A, accepting appointment. Before accepting, you should check with the compliance of various sections of Companies Act 139, 140, 141, etc. 10th one, C for charging fees. Your fees should not be on a pledge or a contingent basis. 11th one, B. B stands for business. You should not be in any other business. Okay, there are some approvals to be given by council, specific approvals and general approvals. Okay, last one, signing. Okay, it's regarding who should sign the report. These 12 are the clauses of first schedule part 1 of Chartered Accountants Act 1949. Today we will deal with second schedule. After completing the schedule, we will come in here and remember this one. Okay, now second schedule. See, first schedule is related to less serious cases. Second schedule is of more serious in nature. Okay, in second schedule, part 1 deals with professional misconduct for members in practice. Okay, clause 1. Second schedule, part 1, clause 1. Okay, a CA is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he discloses information acquired in the course of his professional judgment. It is related to confidentiality again. Okay, to any person other than his client, so engaging him. See, you know, as per SA 200, it is the objective of the audit, it is the, you know, basic requirement to maintain confidentiality. So he cannot disclose the information of the client to other parties. If he has to disclose, either he should take the consent of the client and disclose, or it should be required by the law. Only if any of these two is satisfied, he can disclose the information to other parties. Otherwise, the auditor should not disclose. If he discloses, he will be guilty of professional misconduct as per clause 1. The important part is section 143 subsection 12 of Companies Act 2013. That is reporting to fraud, reporting of fraud to central government of 1 crore or rupees, more than 1 crore. Then this confidentiality clause won't apply here. That means you should disclose it to central government under section 143.12. And you should also link your answer to SA 200. Because as per SA 200, you have to maintain confidentiality. If you don't maintain confidentiality, this clause will be attracted. You should link both of these. No. There is fraud related to income tax and accounts. That fraud may be related to past years or the current year. Okay. If the fraud has happened in the past year, if not represented by member, in the past year, if you are not the representing member, then you should advise the client to make a disclosure. The client should be advised to disclose the all particulars of the fraud in the current year. No obligation to continue. The auditor has no obligation to continue. He can resign from the audit. If examined by a member, if the past year records are examined by the member, then client should be advised to make a complete disclosure. And if the client refuses to make a disclosure, then disassociate. You should discontinue from the audit and report. Okay, this is related to fraud of income tax and accounts happened in the past years. Now, fraud happened in the current year related to accounts or tax. Being prepared. Now, in the current year, obviously you are the auditor, that's why it is attracting here. Now, if the accounts or tax records are being prepared, then advise the client to make a full disclosure. If refuses, full reservation and dissociate with the return. If the client refuses to make a disclosure, then you should dissociate, that is resign, or you should, you know, get out of the audit and make appropriate reservations required there. If CA assignment dispensed with before returns or report, before submitting of return or report, your assignment is completed, your work is done, then no further obligation. Okay, so there are total 4 cases, 2 related to previous years, 2 related to current year. This is the clause 1 of part 1 of second schedule. Now, clause 2, certifies or submits in his name or in the name of the firm a report of an examination of financial statements. Unless examination has been made of statements and records by him, partner, employee or another CA in practice. That means you are given the sign to audit some company and you are signing on that report. You cannot give your signing power or authority or the name of the firm to other parties. Right? So you are the only one who is responsible. However, by him, by himself or partner, your partner can also sign. Your employee, okay, that means these people, when the examination is done by these people, the signing can be done by CA. Another CA in practice, if any other CA in practice, if examination has been done by these 4 people, then you can certify or submit in the name of the firm. What happens if other than these people, someone has examined and you have signed on the behalf of them? Then you will be guilty of professional misconduct as per clause 2. Okay, third clause, a CA is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he permits his name or the name of the firm to be used in connection with the estimate of earnings contingent upon future transactions. That means, for example, a company has approached you for a loan. The banker has asked to prepare 5 years forecast statement. Okay, now the management should prepare the statement and you have to verify the statement and you have to give to the banker. Now, what is your job here? To verify if it is correct or not on the basis of some judgment I have followed. This is the information I have, this is the source data. You know, I am not vouching for the accuracy of the forecast. You have to properly inform him. That is your duty. This clause deals with in connection with the estimate of earnings contingent upon future transactions, because you are giving some forecast data, right? So you are not having confirmation that this happens or this won't happen in a manner where the accuracy of the forecast, it should not be like you are watching for the accuracy. Okay, proper care should be taken. You have to disclose everything about the source data, about the judgments you have, about the nature of the data. This is the clause 3. If you make him believe that you are watching for the accuracy, then you will. Next is clause 4. Expresses his opinion on a financial statements of any business or enterprise in which he, his firm or partner has a substantial interest. you know, one of the basic objective, one of the basic requirement of the auditor is to maintain independence. Now, if any partner or you know, his relative has some substantial interest in the company, then there is no question of independence, right? Independence will be affected. That's why this clause has been introduced. Express his opinion of financial statements in which he, his firm or his partner has substantial interest, including relative as per AS 18. In AS 18, relative definition is mentioned. Wife, son, spouse, you know, father, descendants. There are some definition for relative. All those relatives also are covered here. Whenever you are given a question here, you should link this with section 141(3). That is Companies Act section, which tells about the qualification and disqualifications of the auditors. Okay, when an auditor is having substantial interest, then he is disqualified from the appointment as an auditor. You should mention that point also here. Clause 5. A CA is professionally misconduct if he fails to disclose a material fact known to him which is not disclosed, but disclosure is necessary in making financial statements not misleading. See, financial statement should be true and fair view. They should not be misleading. For making them not misleading, the financial statement have to present some material facts. They should be disclosed. The auditor is not following them. The auditor is failing to disclose a material fact. Then he is guilty as per clause 5. For example, provident fund, superannuity fund, etc. There are some funds, okay? This is an examination question. That's why I mentioned here. Okay. The company has made some defaults relating to PF, superannuity fund, etc. The auditor should disclose them. Okay, but the auditor has failed to disclose. Then he is guilty as per clause 5. Next, clause 6. A CA will be deemed to professionally misconduct if he fails to disclose or report a material misstatement known to him in his professional capacity. See, clause 5 is material fact. Clause 6 is material misstatement. Everything is same otherwise. Example, depreciation is not provided as per Companies Act. Depreciation is not provided. Now, this is a material misstatement. The auditor should provide adequate disclosures, but he failed to do so. So, he will be guilty as per clause 6. Next is clause 7. The auditor does not exercise due diligence or is grossly negligent in the conduct of his professional duties. As per SA 200, the auditor should be maintaining professional skepticism. That is, he should remain alert and he should be aware of the circumstances. But if he is not maintaining due diligence, due care is not taken by him, or he is grossly negligent, okay, then he is guilty of professional misconduct as per clause 7. You should, whenever you get a question from this, you link with SA 240. Okay, fraud. You write about fraud, that you know, auditor is not responsible for identification of fraud. However, the auditor should maintain professional skepticism during the audit. Right, he should be not negligent in his duties. He should maintain proper records, proper documentation, etc. And link with clause 7 here. And another question. The auditor failed to issue audit report within a specified time. Then also, he is grossly negligent. You can link this clause 7. Now going to next one. Clause 8. The auditor fails to obtain sufficient information which is necessary for the expression of opinion. See, how to issue audit report? The basis for the opinion is to gather sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. We discussed that in SA 500 series. Okay, only having sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, then you can give an opinion. You can form the basis of an opinion. What happens if you give an opinion without a sufficient information? Then you will be attracted for clause 8. You will be attracted here. It is known as professional misconduct as per clause 8. Next one, clause 9. Fails to invite attention to any material departure from the generally accepted procedure of audit applicable to circumstances. See, we know what is gaps, right? Generally accepted ones. That means it should be following in a certain way. But the company has defaulted or the company had a departure. That something is not being followed properly. See, the auditor should bring to the attention of the users that this is not being followed. If the auditor fails to bring, then he will be professionally misconduct as per clause 9 here. The last clause, clause 10. The auditor fails to keep money of the client other than those of fees or remuneration or money to be expended in a separate bank account. That is, see, if you have the money of the client, you should not use it because you are acting as a trust of the client. Okay, you are acting as an agent in some cases. Then you should put it in a separate bank account. And you should also see why the client has given you the amount to use such money for purposes for which they are intended within a reasonable time. Okay, the client has given you for some specific purpose. First thing is, you have to keep in a separate bank account. Second thing is, you have to use it for that purpose only within the specified time. Even if you contradict one of the cases here, you will be guilty of professional misconduct. Example, client has gone abroad. Okay, he has paid you a certain amount. Let us say for income tax or GST or TDS, he has given you some amount telling to pay for that taxation. Now, you should keep in a separate bank account and you should also pay that amount to the appropriate authorities within the appropriate time. That is your duty. This is clause 10. See, if you closely observe here, clause 5, 6, 7, are very closely related. Whenever you get a question, you may not differentiate between these three clauses because these three are equally applicable to some circumstances. Then you can mention all of these three and write the answer. Now let's go for the part 2. Part 1 is for members in service. Part 2 is for members of the institute in general. General means both service members and practice members also. Part 2, clause 1. A member of the institute, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he contravenes any of the provisions or regulations or guidelines. Okay, institute has given some provisions, regulations, guidelines. If the member, he may be a practicing member or a service member, if he contravenes any of these things, he will be guilty of professional misconduct. What are some of the regulations? First thing, monthly stipend. The CA in practice, that is the principal, he should be giving monthly stipend to his article students. If he fails in doing so, he will be guilty. Okay? There is a question. Every month stipend is to be paid, right? One CA, he has not paid for 6 months. After 6 months, he has paid the stipend along with some interest to the article students. Then will he be guilty of this clause? Yes, he is guilty because stipend should be provided monthly on a timely basis. Articles deed to ICAI. The principal, that is the CA, is responsible to provide articles deed to ICAI. If he is not providing, he will be guilty. Next, loan. Not a consideration to admit an article. See, you should not take any consideration of any form when you are taking someone as your article students. Okay, the example here is loan. You should not take loan directly from the article student or indirectly from him where he is related to any company or such like that. If article is interested in some company, you should not take loan from that company also. However, if article's relative is interested, suppose article, you are joining an article, the article's father, he is interested in some company, you are taking loan from that company, then there is no problem. The regulation says only to article student, but not article's relative. No premium should be accepted by CA from the article. No premium. That is, you should not take any type of amount from the article. Practice shall be performed only after getting COP. Before getting COP, certificate of practice, you should not practice, right? If you are practicing, then you will be guilty of clause 1 of part 2 of second schedule of Chartered Accountants Act 1949. Now, going to clause 2. Being an employee of any company, firm, or a person discloses confidential information. Same, this thing also is same as a confidentiality thing. Okay, SA 200, link to SA 200 and write the answer. Except first one is when the law requires, second one is permitted by employer. Generally, it is permitted by client, but here you are an employee of the company. That's why you are writing permitted by employer. This is clause 2. Clause 3 includes any information, statement, written or form to be submitted to Institute Council Committee, Director of Discipline, Board of Discipline, Quality Review Board, etc., knowing them to be false. See, if you remember, in the first schedule we have studied, the auditor is failing to disclose the information. That is covered in the first schedule. Second schedule saying you are giving false information, knowing them to be false. That is less serious, this is more serious. So it is covered in the second schedule. This is clause 3. Clause 4. Defalcates or embezzles money received in his professional capacity. For example, you are working as an auditor. Okay. You are embezzled with money. You have taken the amount from the office and you went away. Or you are misappropriating some money. Then you are guilty as per clause 4. By this we completed part 2. Now part 3. Other misconduct. Members in general. Okay. Third part is for other misconduct. Part 1 and 2 are for professional misconduct. See, other misconduct means they are also related to his personal life, not only his professional life. Because a chartered accountant should also be more vigilant in his professional life also to maintain the credibility of the profession. So, other misconducts are also covered. A member of the institute, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of other misconduct if he is guilty by any civil or criminal court for an offense which is punishable for more than 6 months imprisonment. If more than 6 months imprisonment is given by any court, civil or criminal court, for any offense not related to professional offenses, then also he is covered in part 3, other misconduct. So by this we have completed 3 parts of the second schedule. First is for members in practice, second is for members in general, third is for other misconduct. Now we will see how to remember these things. We have completed this first schedule. Second schedule part 1 contains 10 clauses. You remember these small lines. Don't cheat, friends. It may make good impression go bad. You take the first letters DCFIMMAGB. Okay, write this. So there are 10 letters here for 10 clauses. First D is for disclosure. Nothing but confidentiality. You should not disclose information to others without getting client's permission or if law requires. Second one, certifying. You know, that is related to certifying the financial statements without examining them by yourself or your partner or your employee or other chartered accountant practice, without getting them examining, you are certifying them. Third is for future forecast. We should not vouch for the accuracy or the future forecast. Fourth one is for I stands for interest, substantial interest. Okay, fifth one, M stands for material facts. The chartered accountant failed to disclose material facts. Sixth one, M again stands for misstatements, failed to report material misstatements. Next one, seventh one, G, grossly negligent. You know, grossly negligent, he is not performing his duties. Eighth one, I stands for information. The auditor should have sufficient information for the basis of opinion. If he is not getting sufficient information and reporting on financial statements, he is guilty as per 8th clause. 9th one, G, generally accepted auditing practices. If he is not following them, he should report, otherwise he is guilty as per clause 9. Last one, B for bank account. There should be a separate bank account as we had discussed. So these are the 10 clauses of second schedule. So we have completed professional ethics part 1 and part 2 successfully. Thank you so much.